You know, humor. Humor is, God invented humor.
Yeah.
Humor met me at the front door today when I walked in. The very first thing the first person said to me when I walked in the front door, "You're not going to walk in the ladies' room again, are you?" First thing. And you can rest assured that when I had to use the men's room, that I checked the sign, not once, not twice, but three times. Kept looking straight, man, suit, men. No woe in front of it. And I walked in, and I breathed a sigh of relief when I saw two other men in there. So I had it right this time. When we go through life, many times you tuck things away as a nice memory, but every once in a while, something serves as a great spiritual illustration. And I want to bring you back to 1969, Dateline, as Ted Baxter would say, Dateline, 1969. Mount Pleasant Elementary School, New Bedford, Massachusetts, my hometown, fifth grade. I was in fifth grade at the time. And during recess, one of the things that we did is we went out to the schoolyard and we would play kickball. Kickball is played just like baseball, except that you have this big rubber ball and you kicked it instead of using a bat. And it was one of my favorite sports only because I wasn't half bad at it. Everything else I was terrible at, hockey and baseball, basketball, forget it. Kickball, I was okay. I wasn't the best, but I wasn't the worst. And so when two people were picked and people were picking people to be on their teams, I was usually somewhere in the top 50% or so. Not because I was a terrible defensive player, but I was an okay offensive player. When the ball came, I usually had either a single or a double, a base hit. And so I wasn't half bad. So I would get picked somewhere in the middle. So I kind of liked kickball. But every once in a while, not often, but every once in a while, the teacher let me be a team captain. And what that meant is that you had two people, and then you had your fifth grade classmates in front of you, and you got to pick who would be on your team. And when I was team captain, when I got to pick first, invariably, the number one person I would always pick on my team was a person named Bob Landry. Now, Bob Landry was the athlete of the fifth grade class. But you would not have been able to tell that by looking at him because, you see, Bob Landry was very vertically challenged. But what he really lacked in the vertical stature, he made up for hugely in his strength. This guy was unbelievable. I mean, we were all amazed when we were doing the presidential fitness standards that we had to do in fifth grade. You had to do certain sit-ups, you had to do the 100-yard dash in X number of seconds, la-da-da-da-da. One of the things was chin-ups. And we had a chin-up bar at the back edge of the door. And, you know, most people, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, 3, it's going to end up at 3, and they let go. And here comes Bob Landry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And we're looking at it, we're going, oh my goodness. 1, 2. And we're just going, 20, 25. Okay, everybody. 30, 31, 32, 33. I mean, you just kept going on and on and on. I mean, I remember, and I may be remembering incorrectly because time has a tendency to exaggerate, but I don't think so in this case. I think it was somewhere between 30 and 50 pull-ups. And he finally got tired and he goes, yeah. He was the only boy in our class, the only student that could do a single-handed chin-up. And he would do this. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this guy was, you did not want to be on the bad side of Bob Landry. Bob Landry, though, always had friends around him. I don't think he had any enemies as far as I knew. And he was just a really neat guy to have around. I would always pick Bob. So if I had Bob on my team, our team was in great shape. So what does that have to do with prayer? Well, that's coming up in just a second, because I've got a little side story to tell you about Bob before I continue. You see, after graduating in 1977 from high school, no such thing as the internet. You go on with your life, you go into college, you make new friends, and most of the friends that you had in high school, you had a tough time keeping up with. I had one or two. And finally, it was only one. It was Jim Buckley, because he lived right next door to me, and he was only born 8 days after me, so we were best friends, and we still remain very good friends to this day. We're in constant contact with each other, typically via email, every once in a while when I get to go home to New Bedford. Bob Landry, I had no idea where Bob went, what he did in life. Fast forward to a couple of years ago when I was writing The Extra Mile. Some of you bought the book, and you may have read Bob Landry's name in there, because I talked about the strongest kid in our class was Bob Landry. As I'm writing this, and I'm beginning to, you know, wonder where all of my classmates were. All of a sudden, out of the clear blue sky, I get a Facebook message from Bob Landry. It was the Bob Landry that I knew in elementary school. He was living in Florida, and I said, "Bob, you won't believe that I'm writing a book, and I just wrote your name, and you popped up on Facebook." I said, "I've got so much to tell you. I've got to share this book with you." It was essentially my testimony. I wanted him to have it. Little did I know that 5-10 years before, he had committed his life to Christ and was serving Christ with all his heart. And we were just so excited. We got to meet in Florida, where he met, or where he lived, and where we went down for my father-son vacation, father-son retreat. We just had a grand old time, and he talked about his testimony. And, you know, here's this guy who had force behind him, a little fella, but man, you just did not want to get in his way. And he let you know that you should not get in his way in high school. And here he is, just serving Christ with all of his spirit. Really neat. And he's back in New Bedford now, and he'll probably be seeing this on YouTube, because I'm recording this. Hi, Bob. Everybody say, "Hi, Bob." Got a lot of people here now. You have to come and preach here, Bob. He's a good guy. Anyway, picking the right person to back you on the kickball team is just like picking the right person to be praying for you when you need prayer. You don't want to mess with it. When you're going through a valley, when you're going through a trial, let me ask you something, and I'm asking you rhetorically, but think about in your mind who it is that you ask to pray for you when you're going through that trial. It's always good to have somebody behind you praying, and just like this week, we were praying for Pastor Mike, we were praying for Tanya, we were praying for Jean Ann and the families surrounding. It's good to know that you've got good prayer warriors behind you. Do you ever go through a conversation with somebody, somebody's having a hard time, and you say, "Well, I'll pray for you"? Who's done that here? Almost everybody. Now, my follow-up question, how many people here have actually forgotten to pray for that person? Here's the solution. Pray right then and there. Does not matter where you are. And again, another side. I've got a lot of side stories to tell you. I hope I don't lose track of the main message. But when I was in downtown Cleveland once, this lady came up to me and she was just bleeding her heart. "Would you please pray for me? I'm doing this. I'm doing that. I hear you're a man of faith." And I said, "Okay, let's pray now." She was right here on the. Yeah, people were walking through the sidewalk. Yeah, we're right in downtown Cleveland. I said, "Yeah, why not? Let's pray right now." Okay. Little did I know, she knew somebody at Channel 8, our mailroom clerk, and she shared that story with him, and he later told me, "You don't know how extraordinarily of an extraordinary blessing you were to this lady. She said that you took the time to pray for her right then and there. So do it. Don't ever hesitate. Open up your Bibles today to the Gospel of John. We're going to spend a little time in the Gospel of John, chapter 17. Who is praying for you today? See, two glasses of water, and I've been told, I'm keeping them straight. One is for Pastor Mike, and one is for me. The blue one, I finally remembered is Pastor Mike's because it's blue sky. But the clear, because it's clear sky, and that's a Nackett sky. Who knows what Nackett's is? All right. Say amen when you get to John chapter 14.
Amen.
Everybody's there. 17, I'm sorry, 17. Did I say?
When you get to 17.
I want you to, everybody read 7 through 17 and do it in 20 seconds. Ready? Go. John 17. And in John 17, verses 1 through 26, Jesus is praying to God the Father. But what I really want to specifically hone in on today is verses 20 through 26. So let's read it together. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also, which shall believe in me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also might be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, and they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and you, and rather thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them, and thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love therewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. Praise God. Now Jesus was in an intimate one-on-one communication with the Father. However, that prayer was meant to be heard by the disciples. Why do I say that? It's because it was included in the scriptures. It was recorded. It was recorded for their benefit. It was recorded for our benefit. Jesus' prayer is just like the pastoral prayer that you hear Pastor Mike or any one of the servants of God here pray. It is a pastoral prayer meant for the benefit of all the hearers. Now, it's important to look at the historical timetable here. This recorded prayer was shortly after the Last Supper and probably still in the upper room, mind you, in the late night events just before the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, in the Synoptic Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the overview of the Last Supper, the whole thing is less than a chapter. But in John, the Last Supper events begin at chapter 13 and goes all the way to chapter 18. Verse 20, my prayer is not for them alone. You see, just prior to his prayer's conclusion, Jesus specifically prayed now for his disciples. And he did so often in his ministry, didn't he? You see that throughout all of the Gospels. Well, just as parents pray for their children, Jesus did likewise because he knew he was about to leave them. And just when you're about to leave, maybe on a long trip, and you have little ones, don't you like to gather them around and pray for them? Pray for your spouse. Pray for their protection while you're gone. Well, Jesus said, I pray for those who will believe. Oh, there's a change in tense here, isn't there? Ah, interesting. I pray for those who will believe in me through their message. Guess what? Guess who was praying for me and you 2,000 years ago?
Amen.
Jesus was praying for me. He was praying for Pastor Mike. He was praying for everyone here in this room. Plus, it's actually a two-part prayer. Jesus was praying for each of us in the future tense, and he knew that there would be many others who would trust him for what he came to do, because watch what it says here. I pray for those who will believe in me through their message. Note here that Jesus was giving his disciples a hint of what they would be doing. And notice that Jesus gives us a hint today of what we need to be doing, sharing his love with the world. And he is praying for us today. He knows that we're going to encounter people this week, maybe in your office. Maybe in the street. Maybe it's somebody who kind of sort of knows you and stops you in the street and asks for prayer. Well, you have a chance to minister to that person and share the love of God. Jesus is praying for you. He's praying for you that he's going to give you that strength. He's praying for God the Father and the Holy Spirit to indwell you and to give you the strength to do what he has already ordained for you to do, and that is to share the love of God. Well, Jesus would not be here on the earth much longer. He was going to go back to heaven to prepare a place. And not only was this a command for the disciples, but as I mentioned, it's a command for us too. When was the last time you shared your faith in Jesus with someone? Think about that for a second. Or maybe you had the opportunity and you blew it. I'm going to be the first one. Raise my hand. Yet, Jesus was preparing us for each of those encounters by praying for us. By praying for us for strength, for to be the light that he called us to be. You see, the gift of salvation is most enjoyed. It really is when you share it with others. You can't hoard that. You can't. I can't hoard that. I mean, it's such a great gift. The more you give it away, the more you enjoy it yourself. I will pray for those who will believe in me. Let's read on. Verses 21, 22, and 23. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory with which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be, two, three, four? No, one. Say it together, one. Even as we are one. I in them, thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them, and thou hast loved me. Three places in three verses, Jesus prays for what? He prays for unity. How important do you think that is to Jesus in that prayer? If he prayed for it three times in three verses, it's huge. But what is this unity? What is this unity that Jesus is talking about? I'll tell you, first of all, what this unity is not. This unity is not the kind of unity that negates personality, preferences, and opinions, and options. We all have a unique personality. Jesus is not looking for the kind of unity that looks like it's going to grab us, put us in a stamp, and pop us out, looking identical, thinking identical, speaking identical. No. Christianity would be boring that way. We all bring something to the table. We bring personality. God uniquely designed every single one of us. When he made you, he broke the mold. Thank goodness when he made me, he broke the mold. I'll tell you what kind of unity this is. It is the kind of unity that allows us to bear the same kind of Christian fruit, the fruit of love and grace toward other people. And Jesus himself in John chapter 15 gave a good illustration. He talked about grapes. Remember the vineyard, the grapes, and how we must be attached to the vine. Take a look at the grapes. When you go to, next time you go to the grocery store, if you go grocery shopping today or whatever you do, go by the fruit section and grab a bunch of grapes. Look at each individual grape. Is each individual grape exactly the same? Of course not. Not at all. But what did each individual grape have in common? It was tied to the vine. Fantastic. We are a witness to the world. We're supposed to be anyway. Here's a question for you. Talking about unity, if Jesus brought unity up three times and prayed for us and is backing us, is on our kickball team, as we're out there ministering to the world like we're supposed to be doing and being his representative, will the watching world who have not received Christ as Savior, will they take seriously the gospel message if the church is always fighting within itself? Of course not. They'll say, look at those loons over there. They're all fighting within themselves and, you know, which doctrine is right, these little nuances. Who cares about the nuances? We have Christ as the center. When Christ returns, there'll be no denominations. We'll either be for him or against him. So let's conclude with verse 36. Jesus here is going to be concluding his prayer before things start happening in his life in the Garden of Gethsemane, and just before he gets arrested, and of course, you know what happens after that. Jesus concludes his prayer, I have made you known to them, and we will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. Dwell on that for a second. You know what that's saying? That's saying that Jesus is not going to leave you high and dry until he returns to take us all to be where he is. Matthew 28:20 says, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And that implies that he is with us right now. He is in this room. He is in every believer. He is on your kickball team. Oh, you don't play kickball? Let me show you how. I'll meet you in the back. It's a fun thing. But of course, I hope you don't mind that the first person I'm still going to pick to this day is Bob Landry. Because he's a good kickball, and he's a brother in the Lord. But he's not returned yet, and we can't see him physically. However, when Jesus resurrected from the dead, he was no longer... You see, when Jesus came onto the earth and clothed in a human body, he too was restricted to four dimensions. Height, width, spatially, you know, the X, Y, Z, and time. Those are the four dimensions that we know. Those are the four knowable. But when Jesus resurrected from the dead, he goes beyond those four dimensions. Quick example, it's a lot like Mr. and Mrs. Flat. If I drew a man and a woman on this piece of paper, that man or woman is in two dimensions. However, notice that I'm not in their plane. If I'm not in their plane, they can't see me. But if I do this, suddenly they can see me. I'm in their dimension. And then I'm out of there. Then they can no longer see me if I do this. I'm out of their plane. That's how Jesus was able to come and, after the resurrection, dine with the disciples and walk through walls. And eat fish with them, and then suddenly disappear again. He was able to He was way beyond four dimensions, folks. Just like Mr. and Mrs. Flat. And best yet, Jesus is so close to us, even though he feels so far away. Just like Mr. and Mrs. Flat, I can be so close to this piece of paper, and Mr. and Mrs. Flat don't know it. And yet I'm right there.
Amen.
And that's, you know, Jesus, and we're going to enjoy those dimensions in time when he comes to get us, and in the new heaven, the new earth. Just wait till you see the, just wait till you see the dimension of music. I was going to preach on music today. Maybe I'll come back and preach that one now. Wait till you hear the dimensions of music that we're missing out on in heaven. I think that music is going to be far more beautiful than it is here. This is just a little, I mean, literally, just a little tip of the iceberg. But because we live in the Spirit, and because he has regenerated us, we were dead in spirit before Christ. Dead. Dead as this pulpit. But when Christ came into your life, you became alive. You suddenly have a spiritual dimension. Now you've got a fifth dimension, and you're not even singers. That was a joke. For those of you that remember the fifth dimension. We won't go there. If you're young folks, it's like, what is he talking about? See me or Pastor Mike. We'll explain it to you. But Christ is ready to back your kickball team. So the first person you ask to pray for when you're facing a challenge, or when you're about to share Christ, or just walking out the door. Oh, you know, I want Pastor Mike to be praying for me. And I know that he and Jean Ann do pray for me and my family. And I've got a host of people that back me in prayer. But the first person I want to pray for me is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he already did 2,000 years ago. And it's recorded in Scripture, John chapter 17, verses 20 through 26. If you are down and out and you're feeling blue, read John 17, 20 to 26, because Jesus has been praying for you right here, right now, and today. And if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, he's still praying for you. He's praying that you will come into his fold and you will receive the gift that he has waiting for you. And what's that? Free of charge. But yet it cost God everything he had, and that was his Son. Every eye closed, every head bowed. Let's pray together. And if you today have decided that, yep, I want Jesus to be praying for me. I want him to be praying for me for power, and I want him to save me. Well, the first prayer is, Lord, save me. And it's as simple as that. So let's pray together. Father in heaven, I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe that he came in the flesh and died for my sin, the penalty that I deserve, and in my place, so that he can rescue me. He is the great rescuer, praise God. And today, I receive him as Lord and Savior. I receive him as rescuer. And Father, I want him on my kickball team. And so today, I walk in confidence, knowing that you have done this gracious thing. And I know that even 2,000 years ago that he prayed for me today. Eyes still closed, head still bowed. If you prayed that prayer today for the first time, would you raise your hand? And it's just between you and the Lord Jesus, you and God the Father and the Holy Spirit. Just raise your hand. If you today have, thank you. If you've made that commitment today, if you're making a recommitment today, realizing that you've not been asking Jesus to back you in prayer, and you want that. Would you raise your hand today? Thank you. Fantastic. As we close in prayer today and maybe singing the last hymn, for those that raised their hand who would like to come forward, I'm sure that the elders and pastor and myself will be up here to pray with you. And to congratulate you on your new journey and your new status as a child of God. Amen and amen.